Bene, adesso per introdurre il dottore, il professor José Rubira Torres, che è nato a Sant'Antonio de Rio Blanco, alla provincia di Havana, e che ieri è rimasto incantato, interessato dall'acqua minerale Sant'Antonio e dalla città del comune di Rubira che porta proprio il suo nome, con interesse sull'origine del suo nome. È laureato in meteorologia e dottore in scienze geografiche, ha studiato in corsi post laurea nell'Unione Sovietica, Stati Uniti e Cuba. E tengo a sottolineare che la meteorologia è senza confini, la cooperazione in meteorologia c'è sempre stata, è importante lo scambio di dati perché è a base delle previsioni, quindi al di là delle posizioni e delle contrapposizioni anche di quei periodi, lo scambio dei dati, ma ce lo dirà meglio lui, era fondamentale per tutti gli stati e per tutti i blocchi per la previsione e la protezione della popolazione. È presentatore delle notizie meteorologiche nel notiziario nazionale della televisione cubana dal 13 gennaio 1981, dirige il Centro Nazionale di Previsioni dell'Istituto di Meteorologia dal 1988, ha presentato lavori e conferenze in molteplici eventi nazionali e internazionali e collaborato come consigliere di vari servizi meteorologici stranieri, è vicepresidente del Comitato per gli Uragani dell'Organizzazione Meteorologica Mondiale nella regione americana e membro del gruppo esperti nella comunicazione ed educazione del WMO, sempre l'Organizzazione Meteorologica Mondiale, professore nella carriera della laurea in meteorologia dell'INSTEC, che credo sia un istituto superiore tecnico di Cuba, e membro dell'Associazione Cubana dei Comunicatori. Aggiungo, credo di aver letto che lo scorso anno ha avuto anche una laurea honorem dall'Università di Santa Clara, giusto? Una città di Cuba. Ecco, io darei proprio la parola al dottor Rubira, che ci parlerà proprio di uragani, prevenzione e protezione della popolazione. Benvenido.
Bueno, ante todo, deseo agradecer al profesor Alessandro Capra por sus atenciones, por estar aquí, al buen amigo Luca Lombroso, que también ha sido uno de los artífices de que podamos estar aquí comunicándonos con ustedes. Estoy hablando en castellano, muy lento, espero que se entienda. Pero para hacer las cosas mejor, vamos a hablar en inglés en esta conferencia. No obstante, cualquier pregunta, cualquier aclaración, si algo pasa con el italiano, aunque lo comprendo algo, si me hablan lento, tenemos también a Luca que me puede traducir. Vamos a hablar acerca... we are going to have this talk about hurricane risk reduction in Cuba. We will go to several topics because we will not be talking only about hurricanes. We will begin by talking about the main weather-related hazards in Cuba. Then we will talk a little about the climate change issue because this an issue that is getting an influence, a big influence in these problems. Then about tropical cyclone early warning system in Cuba and some lessons that we have learned in Hurricane Sandy, that was the last hurricane to hit Cuba in the eastern part of the country. Well, these are the main weather hazards in Cuba. This is an important issue, the leading time for warning. In tropical cyclone, including the pre-formation stage, we have a long leading time, up to 120 hours, it is 5 days. Of course, that we don't issue a warning to evacuate at this long time, but we are preparing people. We have an early warning here to prepare people in order to get acquainted with the hurricane, what is the track, how it is moving, what are the main features. And then we have the watch. The watch is this, in yellow, from 36 to 72 hours. And the warning is issued with 36 to 0 hours in this time, mostly 36 to 24 hours before the hurricane arrival. But we also have strong winds, greater than 55 kilometers an hour, that are not associated with tropical cyclone. Could be a cold front in winter or a low pressure system in winter. We have heavy or intense rainfall, more than 100 millimeters in 12 to 24 hour period over a big area. And also severe local storms into a synoptic system that could be a cold front, could be a squall line, or any other system. And we have coastal flooding with wave height greater than 4 meters that gets along the shores, on the northern coast or the southern coast of Cuba, with a coastal inundation that could be several blocks inside the city with thousands of people living there. And here, I have put it aside, the locally generated severe local storm with a very small lead time. This is a big problem because we don't have time enough to warn people. So, just an hour or less. This is not much. This was a severe storm that developed rapidly just in front of Havana, a city with 2 million inhabitants. Only a 20-minute lead time to warn. Of course, the warning couldn't go through. Nobody received it before the event, but it was a very severe event in a big city. So you may see here the heaviest precipitation fell in about 20 minutes. Greatest amounts in downtown Havana, 239 millimeters in Plaza de la Revolución. So it is a real challenge because the city's normal life was completely disrupted in 15 minutes. At the time where people are getting out of work or getting out of school and going to home. So everybody was on the move in the city. But the traffic was completely closed. The transportation system was completely down. The night fell of this flooded city without electric power. Havana completely underwater. And the most intense rainfall lasted less than half an hour. What can we do with this? Well, in Rome, I went to a meeting that had to do with CAP. CAP is a common alert protocol. It is a very simple way of getting a warning message across people. In cell phones, email, but most of them is a push these messages into cell phones. That's something that we are working about. It's something that the World Meteorological Organization is trying to convey to everyone, because CAP would have been the fast, reliable means for warning to go through in a short time. This is a real challenge that we have with this short living, impressive impact of these local storms. But let us talk about hurricanes. Hurricanes are one of the major threats that Cuba, as well as US and Mexico and the whole Caribbean, face this year in what is called the hurricane season, from June, 1st of June, to the November the 30th. These are the hurricanes. You may see that some of them come from Africa all the way through the Caribbean and the United States. Some others go in the open sea. That is not a problem to anybody. But the activity of tropical systems in the Atlantic is not the same in all decades. We have a multi-decade mode. You may see here from 1870 to 2004, with times, several years of great activity, several years of low activities, and then several years of high activity. And we have from 1969, 1970, up to 1996 here, 1995, we have a low era of tropical storms in the Atlantic. Some years have some, yes, But in the overall, it is not much. However, since 1995, we became another era of tropical storm high activity. These are the named storms in the Atlantic, and it is very interesting to know that the greatest level of cyclonic activity since 1886 in the Atlantic Basin has been recorded in this 70-year period from 1995 to 2012. It is very important because it means that something more is working. In these 17 years, the figure of hurricanes and tropical storms have doubled since any other high activity similar period before, but also 2.5 times more major hurricanes. Major hurricanes are the strong ones, category 3, 4, 5, has been recorded. And maybe it has to do with climate change, because we may see here all forces, natural forces and anthropogenic forces. The IPCC stated in the last assessment that climate change is an issue that is real, and it is because of anthropogenic sources. This is the surface temperature anomalies during the most recent inactive and active Atlantic hurricane period. You know that hurricanes grow with the warmth of the sea. We need more than 26.5 degrees of temperatures in the surface of the sea to have a hurricane or tropical storm to develop. So, in inactive period, we have low temperatures in the ocean, but see how great it is in the active periods. And what is projected in climate change environment? Well, we may have, these are the models, different models. We could have an increase as high as 3.8 degrees in the sea level, sea water temperature, as low as 1.6 degrees. But the median is about here. It's about 2.5 degrees. And we were here in 1913. In 1915, we are here. So we are just here. And the simulations of the numerical models of what could happen in the climate change environment is that we have a tendency towards more category 5 hurricanes, stronger hurricanes in the Atlantic. And also, this simulation have a significant a more near storm rainfall for water climate condition, around 12% more per degree Celsius. So we will have more rainfall in tropical cyclones and hurricanes. And this is a reality check, comparing model with the actual observations. We may see here how close they are about what is happening right now. We'll go a little far. Well, here's Cuba. Here's Cuba, and you may see how many hurricanes crosses over the island. And the major natural catastrophes in Cuba, in Cuba history, have been associated with hurricanes. For instance, Santa Cruz del Sur, hurricane November 1932, casualties 3,033. This was a category 5 hurricane. And intense rainfall, because it was a storm surge, a big surge in the seawater level, wall of sea of seawater coming into the city and vanished the city already. Intense rainfall with total amounts of 1,800 millimeters in 72 hours in Hurricane Flora gave 1,159 people dead in this kind of event. And the material loss is very high, $300 million in 1963 values. It will be much more right now. Now, the principle of the Cuban early warning system. We have a wide legal basis, clearly defined mission for every one of the actors, objectives and functions. All a step in the tropical cyclone disaster management are followed. There is a full coordination among main actors, a complete observing system for the country, and we also have operational manual that regulates all actions in the National Forecast Center. Quality management system is enforced since last year. And the use of media by specialists, mainly radio and television, with graphics and plain, simple words, that is something very important because everybody understands the information and be urged to take actions. The wide legal basis is made in several laws and decree law and guidelines that we have it on screen. And the main elements is that the National Forecast Center of INSMET, that is the Institute of Meteorology, and their territorial branches is in charge of monitoring and forecasting tropical cyclones. And I might add that also all kinds of meteorological hazards. Authorities at the different levels of government implement protection measures advised by the officials and experts of the civil defense. Now the social organizations and the media from national to local level disseminate the information. And the citizens have good education and are well organized and prepared. The specific functions of the Cuban National Forecast Center is to constantly monitor weather, to issue timely early warning to the government, the civil defense, and the people on any hazardous weather system that could affect any part of the country, and to transmit early warnings and warnings through the media, mainly TV and radio, updating the information frequency. Sometimes we are on air almost every hour. We have our working place here, and by that place is the television set to go on air live every hour. And also in what I might call a peaceful time with no hurricane, with no tropical storm in the neighborhood, to participate in awareness and educational activities. So Cuba has implemented all steps in the DC disaster management, the prevention, risk assessment and planning, the preparation with the public education, the response with forecasts, early warning, watches and warning, and actions to protect people, and the recovery, because after the storm, you have to reestablish the basic services, the forecasts and warnings for the affected area. And meteorologists in the National Forecast Center are involved on all these steps of the disaster management. So to face a hurricane threat, we have a strong partnership between the National Forecast Center, the civil defense, and the media. And the public information comes from the National Forecast Center from the scientific point of view. We say this is a hurricane or a tropical storm that's coming. We have this and this hazard that we come of a loss. And the civil defense and the government issues at the same time a warning note stating that people should this region evacuate or should do this and these things to preserve life and preserve properties. And both messages, independently but coordinated, goes to the media and then to citizens. The National Forecast Center issues meteorological warnings on tropical storms or tropical cyclones in a very simple way, with clear, concise, and comprehensive words for everybody. At the same time, the National Civil Defense issues a warning note, advises the population what to do, and national TV and radio broadcast the warnings live, with even the remote unit installed at the National Forecast Center. The Cuban Meteorological Service were prepared. For the size of the country, we have enough with one National Forecast Center. We have 15 provincial forecast departments, 68 meteorological stations, 8 meteorological radar that covers the entire country, and one meteorological satellite ground station. But the most important factor is the human resource. Human resource with knowledge and human resource with experience. This is our weather station plus 60 new automatic weather stations that have been installed. This is our radar network coverage. This covers or Cuba and also the seas that are surrounding us and permanently monitors weather. Then all information of models, satellite radars, numerical models, comes to the National Forecast Centers, and then the forecast warnings are issued. And there is a response by the civil defense, the government, and the citizens. And also weather information. People who are on TV are meteorologists, meteorologists from the National Meteorological Center. They are have a contract with the TV, which add to their with their contract with the Meteorological Center. It's very nice because people like to do that. And at the same time, we have people with good knowledge, meteorological knowledge, experience that belongs to our meteorological service, that are the ones that give issue the information on TV and radio. Well, all hurricane expected impacts are addressed in detail. Well, the track, the expected wind field, areas with intense and heavy rainfall, and also our models for forecasting storm surge. I always say that this simple map saved many lives, saved 2,000 lives. There is a town here, a fisherman town, that on August the 12th of 2004, there was a hurricane coming. And at 9 a.m. this morning, I began showing this map on TV because the wave here will come so high as 4 meters, and it was a very low land. So everybody evacuated themselves at that time. And the complete town was destroyed, but no one lost his life. So this information, the very clear weather, a very clear way can save many lives. So meteorology and the civil defense gave the word. It's the warning plus confidence, because people are confident on this and gets to people's action. I will show you now a list of tropical storms and hurricanes that have affected Cuba in this intense period from 1995 to 2012. It was the last year in which Cuba was affected by a hurricane. You see here, the fatalities are very low. This is the greatest amount in Hurricane Dennis, because this province had never had a strong hurricane before and had problems with the electricity, so the people couldn't hear, listen to the radio or watch TV to know the message. So the message was taken house to house, but this was the amount of people fatality there. And with Sandy, the last one, 2012, we had 11. But see the economic damages, very, very large. Only in 2008, with 3 hurricanes, major hurricanes, and 1 tropical storm, we had $10 billion of economic damage. And now, I will talk about Hurricane Sandy. It was the last one that hit Santiago de Cuba here. It was a major hurricane category 3, and get hit through again as a category 2. Here is Santiago de Cuba, and there were no historical memories of people living there of a hurricane. So it is important, because old people say, well, we had a hurricane many years ago, and this. And that memory is very important, because it is transmitted to younger people. But in this case, there was no historical memory of a strong hurricane in Santiago de Cuba. We have a hurricane coming from the east to west and southeast to northwest, but never from the south, and never a strong hurricane. Here's Santiago de Cuba Bay. It is the second largest city in Cuba. Only 2 hurricanes had its track near the city since 1851, only 2. There were no strong hurricanes in city history, and this was the first one, Sandy. And Sandy developed from category 1 to category 3 only 12 hours. And this is what has been happening in the last years. It is also a consequence of climate change, that hurricanes come from category 1 to the largest category in very few time, in just hours. So it is important when you have a hurricane, the hurricane is category 1, category 2, and 12 hours later you have a category 3 major storm. So it is very, very important to know this. And this is was a track. We had a good forecast. Early warning was issued 72 hours in advance. TV and radio broadcasted live from the National Forecast Center since 48 hours before landfall. A special TV and radio program in National Network was permanently on air 24 hours before landfall. Other missions were taken by the civil defense. However, this big city was located under the ring of maximum winds. Several tornadoes and mini swirls were reported, and winds were enhanced by the topography of the city surrounded by mountains. And here is the storm surge, 2 meters in the city. Wave up to 4-6 meters came over here. Here's the city, and destroyed all along this shoreline. This was what happened. The total sea height in the coast was 7 to 9 meters, like a wall of seawater, and rainfall excess of 200 millimeters in several places. So the speed of the current reaching the coast were 5.3 meters per second, while the average was 3 meters per second. This is a destruction, big floodings. This is concrete pole. This is what happened here in Santiago de Cuba. And only 9 people died in Santiago de Cuba and 2 in Guantanamo. Total of 11 fatalities in this major hurricane. So the conclusion is that the entire hurricane Atlantic region is embedded into a period of high tropical cyclone activity. And this current period is stronger than any previously known. The amount of major hurricanes has been the greatest ever recorded. This situation may become worse when we have a climate change environment. And what we are doing to face this ongoing problem are really adaptations to climate change. We have designed an early warning system for tropical cyclone that covers all aspects, legal, structural, institutional, and public. And there is a strong partnership because the Meteorological Service has the independence to give the warnings, and the civil defense also has the independence to give the warning but of what should be done by people. But it is coordinated. Coordinated so that we really have one voice in the country. And the amount of people dead in tropical storm and hurricanes are a minimum, also the smallest recorded in all the Americas, despite this intense tropical cyclone activity in the area. Nevertheless, the lessons learned with Hurricane Sandy in eastern Cuba calls for making greater efforts when dealing with people that lack historical experiences in a particular place, mainly in big cities, increasing awareness on the onset of every new hurricane season. Because no region of the country is vaccinated against major hurricanes or hurricanes that develop fast, or hurricanes that develop with a track that follows a rare behavior regarding long period climatological records. So that is my presentation. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, please.
Se ringrazio veramente il dottor Rubiera. Se c'è qualche domanda, qualche curiosità sugli uragani, sul servizio meteo Cuba, su qualsiasi cosa, coglierei già l'occasione ora per fargliela. Potete farla in italiano, in inglese o se ha bisogno poi lo aiuto. Ci sono alcuna pregunta?
Sì, se hai alcuna pregunta.
If you have some questions? O alla fine della... Vi passo un attimo...
Thank you very much, Dr. Rubiera, for your very clear presentation.
Yes. Thank you very much for your very nice talk. You have focused your attention on the forecast of hurricanes and the early warning system. Of course, this is an essential part of how we can do about these destructive events. But my question is on the what we can do to prepare people for such a very destructive events, and what we can do for designing the structures, and so in such a way to prevent or mitigate the effects of these events, because these are certainly important in Cuba, but could also be important in other areas of the world. Even in Italy, we have what they are called the Mediterranean hurricanes in certain region, and I'm feeling that at least some important structure like dams should be designed to and prepared for these very important events.
Yes. Well, you may have a good forecast, 100% forecast that is not available anywhere in the world, but suppose it is 100% real, and you have the best forecast here, and you put it in a drawer. It is nothing. Nothing. But it is the same that you have this forecast and people cannot understand the forecast. If people cannot understand what you are saying, because maybe you use a technical language, maybe because you are not clear in the way you state the warning. But people should have education. Well, you have to educate, campaigns of education to people, to the media, telling the people, flash floods is this. It is because this very rapid developing storm, or maybe you might have strong winds or tornadoes at this, how to prepare for that, or a hurricane. And you mentioned the Mediterranean. There are lows in the Mediterranean, low pressure systems. Some of them resemble one hurricanes. What could happen when the water in the Mediterranean could be 2, 3, 4 degrees greater than now in the climate change environment? What could happen? So you must, first of all, prepare people by education. Education in many ways. We use television. Television because everybody watches our newscasts and television every day. And we have the opportunity of showing this system, this could be this way and the other. And that's a small bits of information that are getting to the people day by day. So it is something that we can do. Others are TV and radio programs for teaching people, interviews, etc. And also it is very important the printed media, because printed media has a paper and people can keep the paper. But Facebook, social media, internet are also good ways of giving information to educate people. So, first of all, educate people. Secondly, the information should be given out to the people in a clear way, in common words that people understand. And you also might gift people some advices. This is a flash flood. You should not be in low-lying areas. You should protect, go to high places if you are living in a low place that could be flooded. If you are by the river, you have to come out of there. And if there is strong winds, you should do this, this, this. So this is another thing that we can do for people. Advise people on what to do. And to maintain, in the case of hazardous phenomena, maintain an updated of the situation. It is not only that you at 7 a.m. you say this, but you have also to continue with the message as long as the hazards is in effect, or the warning is in effect. And when you finish, you say the hustle, the danger has finished. So you may be quiet now. But this should also be done with a reflection on the laws and regulations. And everything has been written in the operational manual so that you or any other, maybe you are not here tomorrow, but there will be another in your place. And this person knows what to do because they have an operational manual here. So there are many, many things that could be done. In Cuba, we have somewhat of a system that's very well organized. In the case of meteorological aspects, we have a national center that we issue national information. And we have provincial centers. But the provincial center doesn't issue a completely free forecast, have to follow us. We give the forecast for the large area, for the large, for the entire country, without any details. But in the provinces, they make the forecast with detail for the province. In the mountains, by the sea, inland, those are the details. And in the case of severe weather that affects more than one province, it is the national center that gives the information. But it is severe weather for only one province, they are the responsible for that. They have a radar, they have the meteorological station there, network, and they only coordinate with us. We are going to do this. Okay, do it. And the civil defense has the same organization. So at any place, we coordinate with the civil defense at the national level, at the provincial level.
Thank you.
Quanto dirà Recuerdo?
Oh, Recuerdo.
La nostra università e il nostro dipartimento nel 25 anni. Grazie.
Un bello ricordo. Yes, if I am here a few days more, I speak Italian perfectly.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you.